Good morning and welcome to Covenant Presbyterian Church. Romans 1 tells us that God's invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made. And so through floods and earthquakes and eclipses and the beauty of springtime, God demonstrates his eternal power and divine being. And we gather to worship him this morning. We warmly welcome anyone visiting with us this morning and invite you to sign and the register when it's passed around in a little bit and to provide some contact information so we can get in touch with you. Call your attention to just a couple of announcements. There's a bulletin inverse for a one-day men's spring retreat on May 11th. And then this coming Saturday, next week, spring work day from 8 to 1, praying for good weather for that. And at 5 p.m. next Saturday, the youth group's Caribbean dinner, and reminder to sign up for that today. And then finally, next Sunday, new Sunday school classes start up. Here in the sanctuary, Pastor Mulfeld and I will be leading a study on worship. John will start that off next week. And then in room 107, Nate Wombold will lead a discussion of Christian classics. And looking at the final sections of Bunyan's Grace Abounding and a sermon then by Thomas Chalmers. So now as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship, let's reflect on Ezekiel 11, verses 19 through 20. And I will give them one heart, and a new spirit I will put within them. I will remove the heart of stone from their flesh and give them a heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes and keep my rules and obey them. And they shall be my people, and I will be their God.
Good morning. Please join me in our call to worship from Psalm 147. Praise the Lord. How good is it to sing praises to our God?
Praise our Lord in the mighty power. His understanding has no limit.
The Lord sustains the humble, but casts the wicked to the ground. The Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love.
Praise the Lord.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we want to praise you with all our souls, with all our inmost being. We want to praise your holy name. Lord, we want to praise you because we don't want to forget any of your benefits. You are the one who forgive all our sins, who heal our diseases, who redeems our lives from the pit and crowns us with love and compassion. You satisfy our desires with good things so that our youth could be renewed like that of an eagle. We pray, Lord, that you would be with us this morning, that you would reveal your word to us, that you would open our eyes so that we may see the forgiveness that you've bestowed upon us, so that we could become your children. Rekindle our hearts, Lord, so that they may burn as living sacrifices to you. Strengthen our feet and our arms, so that we would not only be hearers of the word, but become doers that trust and obey. And then, Lord, we pray that if there's anyone of your elect here this morning that have not yet turned to you as their only source of salvation, we pray, Lord, that this be the day that they may taste the living water and that they may experience the amazing grace that transcends all understanding and the call to be a faithful witness in this dark world. Lord, we pray that you would bless our time together, and we ask you these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's now praise the Lord from hymn 73, Rejoice, All People, Homage Give.
Thank you.
join me in our prayer of confession as printed in your bulletins. Father in heaven, hear now the forgiveness from God himself, from his word as written in 1 John 3, verses 2 and 3. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Amen. Be seated. Our Old Testament reading this morning is from Hosea. That is on page 757 in the Bibles under the chairs in front of you. So that is from Hosea 11, verse 1 to 11. Now, several times in the Old Testament, God explains the relationship with his people, Israel, as one that is like the relationship between a father and a son. Now, here in Hosea, the Lord laments that his children have continually turned away from him. In God's patience and his mercy, he has held back his parental anger, but it is clear that Israel will never be the faithful son that God called them to be. In our sermon later today, we will see that Jesus came to be the son that Israel failed to be, so that all of those who trust in him can be adopted as God's children. Now listen to God's word from Hosea. Hosea 11, starting at verse 1. When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt, I called my son. The more they were called, the more they went away. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and burning offerings to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up by their arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of kindness, with the bands of love, and I became to them as the one who eases the yoke on their jaws, and I bent down to them and fed them. They shall not return to the land of Egypt, but Assyria shall be their king, because they have refused to return to me. The sword shall rage against their cities, consumes the bars of their gates, and devour them because of their own counsels. My people are bent on turning away from me, and though they call out to the Most High, he shall not raise them up at all. How can I give up on Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my burning anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, For I am God, not a man, the Holy One in your midst, and I will come in wrath. The Lord shall go, they shall go after the Lord. He will roar like a lion. When his roar, his children shall come, trembling from the west. They shall come trembling like birds from Egypt and like doves from the land of Assyria, and I will return them to their homes, declares the Lord. That is the word of the Lord.
Will you please join me in prayer? Our Father, as we've just read, you are the Holy One. You are perfect, infinite in all of your attributes. You're infinite in your wrath, which you described here in Hosea as a burning anger out of which you can easily destroy all those who oppose you. When we read in your word, Lord, about your limitless holy wrath, it is terrifying. And the thought of people suffering under your wrath for all eternity is unimaginable, and yet we know it is just. But Father, we thank you that you are also limitless in your compassion and mercy. There's no limit to the kind of person to whom you can be merciful. There's no sin that is so heinous or committed so many times that you cannot forgive it. No matter how many times your people Israel were unfaithful to you for hundreds and hundreds of years, you were patient and merciful to them, not treating them as their sin deserved. But Lord, how can that be? How can you be both infinite and perfect in both your wrath and your mercy? How does one not trump the other or cancel out the other? And Father, we thank you that you've answered that question once and for all at the cross, that in the death of your Son, you displayed both your perfect justice and wrath and your perfect love and mercy at once and in the very same act. Thank you, Father, that because you are just and because you are loving, you did not spare your own Son, but graciously gave him up for us. And especially as we partake of the Lord's Supper later this morning, would we be mindful of the infinite wrath that you've spared us from because of your infinite love for us in Christ. And as we remember that you gave us your Son, Father, we also thank you that, as Paul says in Romans 8, you will also, along with him, graciously give us all things. And you have given us so much in addition to our salvation. For example, Lord, you've blessed us with an incredibly hardworking, talented, and sacrificial group of volunteers who have been working on the loft over the sanctuary. Thank you for their service, Lord, to us and to you. And we pray now for the work to come, the inspections that need to happen, the next phases, that you would bless them to go forward in a timely fashion, because you've also blessed us with a very full sanctuary, for which we're very thankful. Father, we continue to thank you as well for the folks who are making good recovery from recent operations. And we pray especially at this time for Diana Lowry, who is still suffering from excruciating back pain after a fall last week and waiting for test results so that the doctors can determine the best treatment for her. And we pray that you would continue to give her more relief each day, that you'd strengthen her trust in you, especially, Lord, when it's hard to imagine what your good purposes might be. Father, we also continue to pray for our brother Peter, whose father has been diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer, and that they are now working on the best possible treatment to proceed. So we thank you that in the midst of this horrifically discouraging news, that there is the possibility of treatment, and we pray that you would work through human means to do what is easy for you, not difficult, let alone impossible for you to do, which is bring healing and draw Peter and his family closer to each other and to you through this trial. Father, we thank you as well for the week off that Pastor Mulfeld and his family have had. We pray that it's been a restful and enjoyable time together, and that they aren't overwhelmed by catching up on anything that they've missed while they've been away. And finally, Lord, we pray for this week's featured missionary, Peter Lee, who's a Navy lieutenant and chaplain. We thank you for the good things you're doing among the midshipmen that he serves and among his family as well. And we pray that you'd continue to bless him and his family and his ministry at the Naval Academy. And now, Father, we bring our tithes and offerings to you with gratitude and joy, praying that you'd multiply our humble fish and loaves for your glory and for the good of your church. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please be seated. Our New Testament reading this morning is from Romans 8, verses 12 through 25. That's found on page 944 in the Bibles under the chairs. Throughout our study of Galatians, we've often used Romans as our New Testament reading because of similarities between the two letters. Here in Romans 8, Paul adds a few more details that will help us better understand the implications of our sonship in Jesus Christ that he lays out in Galatians 3 and 4. Note in particular that there is a sense in which our adoption is already realized, but that we continue to wait in patient hope for its complete fulfillment. So we'll read Romans 8, verses 12 through 25. So then, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we ourselves groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Praise God for his holy word.
Well, if you've seen one infomercial, you've seen them all, right? They're all the same basic pattern. First, they identify some need, universal need or problem, usually with a really overdramatic, often black and white reenactment of someone that's just at their wit's end because they can't complete this just very simple household task. You know, their hair's all over the place, the house is a mess, and then the voiceover comes, tired of taking all day to screw in that light bulb. You know, well, not anymore, thanks to the Twist-O-Matic 5000. And then they bring on the celebrity spokesperson, and then along with someone else, a sidekick that's kind of supposed to represent the everyman, the customer, and they're just way over the top enthusiastic, like, wow, this is amazing. Show me what it does again. And then maybe they throw in some pre-recorded testimonials from satisfied customers. Oh, the Twist-O-Matic literally saved my life. And by this point, you know, maybe you're thinking, okay, this sounds kind of neat, but I can always just pick one up next time I'm at the store, but not so fast because this isn't sold in stores and it's only available for a limited time. So how much would you pay for the Twist-O-Matic? $10,000? No, $5,000, not even close. If you call right now, this product can be yours for 17 easy payments of $19.95. And if this isn't the best thing you've ever used, simply return it for a full refund, no questions asked. And if at this point you're still not convinced, the voiceover guy then says, of course, what's next? But wait, there's more. Call now and we'll double your offer because two doohickeys isn't possibly going to be enough, right? And if you return the Twist-O-Matic, the doohickey is yours to keep just for trying it out. So call now, operators are standing by. So infomercials, we've all seen them. We've all rolled our eyes at them. Because in order to convince us that this is something that we need, they have to rely on a lot of exaggeration, over-dramatization to make their point, to make it seem like the problem is much worse than it really is, and that their product is much better and more helpful than it truly is. But when it comes to the gospel, of course, it's impossible to be overly dramatic, to exaggerate too much, to be too enthusiastic about how awful our need is and how greatly God has met that need in Christ. And as we continue in Galatians 3, let's be reminded of just how dire our situation was before Christ came. In verses 10 through 14, Paul says we were under a curse. Verse 23, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. I mean, this is a situation much, much worse than not being able to find the right gadget in your gadget drawer. And the solution to our problem, of course, is much, much better than anything an infomercial could sell. In verse 13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. And in verse 24, Christ came that we might be justified by faith, no longer condemned, right? No longer cursed, but now righteous in God's sight. And that alone is good news, right? So much so that if this were an infomercial, we'd be ready to pick up the phone and call right now. But in our passage for today, Paul is essentially saying, but wait, there's more. If we put our trust in Christ, we're not just acquitted by God as a judge. We are loved and accepted, adopted by him as a father. So let's read what Paul has to say about our adoption in Christ. We'll begin with chapter 3, verse 25, and continue to chapter 4, verse 7. This is God's word. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise. I mean that the heir, as long as he is a child, is no different from a slave, though he's owner of everything, but he's under guardians and managers until the date set by his father. In the same way, we also, when we were children, were enslaved to the elementary principles of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. Praise him for his word. Again, every part of an infomercial is exaggerated. You know, the need or problem you supposedly have, the unique benefits of this product, you know, and how cheap and easy it is for you to get one. But there's no exaggeration in what Paul says here about our adoption. And we're going to look at three aspects of it in this passage. First of all, who adoption is for. Second, how it can be received, and third, what the benefits and implications of it are. So first, who is adoption for? Yesterday, our softball team practiced for the first time, and hopefully it's been made clear over and over again that this is not just for adult men, that we welcome women, we welcome teenagers as young as 15. Our senior fellowship is even more inclusive. I mean, literally, anyone, male or female, of any age is welcome to come. But for obvious reasons, for some of our groups and activities, we have to, restrict it to certain demographics within the church. So if I were to show up Tuesday night at the women's Bible study, they would very firmly but graciously say, you know, beat it, mister. You know, your room's down the hall. This isn't meant for you. And we might think the same thing about adoption here, based on the language that Paul uses. For example, in chapter 4, verses 5 through 7, he says, adoption as sons, because you are sons, and you are no longer a slave but a son. So, you know, it might seem at first read that he's talking about something that's just available for men, and if this were an infomercial, that the women could just change the channel. But the reason Paul uses the word son here is that in that culture, it was the sons who were eligible to inherit the inheritance from their fathers, and we'll talk more about that inheritance in our third point. For now, I just want to make sure the point is clear that Paul isn't using the word son to restrict adoption in any way, to make it sound like only men can be adopted into God's family. He makes that perfectly clear in chapter 3, verse 28. There is no male and female, nor is there Jew nor Greek, nor slave nor free. No matter who you are, adoption into God's family is available to you, so don't change that channel. But your next question might be, okay, I get it that adoption is available to anyone, but how do I receive it? What needs to happen in order for me to become a son of God? And the main thing Paul says at the end of chapter 3 is that adoption is for those who are in Christ Jesus, those who've put on Christ, those who are Christ's, or those who belong to Christ. So in other words, since Jesus is the Son of God, if we are joined to him, then we are sons of God too. And how do we become joined to Christ? Well, Paul says two things here. The first one, not so surprising. He says at the end of verse 26 that it's through faith that we are in Christ Jesus. The other thing Paul says, though, might surprise us a bit. He says in verse 27 that as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ and therefore have become sons of God. So is Paul saying that somehow the water of baptism accomplishes adoption? No, we don't believe that in our denomination, at least. So how do we make sense of what Paul is saying here, or for that matter, what 1 Peter 3:21 says, that baptism saves you? Well, one option is to assume that Paul and Peter are talking about spiritual baptism, or the inward cleansing, newness of life that is represented by the water of baptism. But another option is that both Paul and Peter are talking about water baptism, but they're assuming that faith is part of the equation too. In the early church, the idea of someone believing and not being baptized, that idea was so foreign, so unthinkable to them, that when Paul mentioned the one, when Peter mentioned the one, the readers would have automatically understood that the other one was implied as well. They seem to be seen as two aspects of a single experience of conversion and initiation into the church. So to summarize what Paul has been saying so far about how we are adopted, how we become sons of God, it's by being in Christ through faith as represented in baptism. But if we stopped reading there at the end of chapter 3, we might wrongly assume that how we become sons of God is all about what we do to make ourselves sons of God, and nothing could be further from the truth. Faith only describes how we receive adoption, not what God has done to accomplish it, what God has done to make it available to us in the first place. And that's something that the infomercials don't usually tell you, because they figure that the customer is not really interested in whose idea this product was and who designed it, who produced it, manufactured it at the factory, who delivers it to you. You know, all the consumer cares about is what is this thing, what does it do, and how do I get one? When it comes to our adoption as God's sons, there's nothing more important to understand than what he has done to make it available to us, and that's what Paul explains in chapter 4. And notice that each person of the Trinity is mentioned here. In verses 4 and 6, God refers to the Father. And then in verses 4 and 5, you have the Son. And in verse 6, the Spirit. So each member of the Trinity playing a part in our adoption. So let's look at what Paul says about each one. In verse 4, it says, God the Father sent forth his Son when the fullness of time had come. So fullness of time, that implies advanced purpose and planning. And we know from Ephesians chapter 1 that it was before the foundation of the world that the Father chose us and predestined us for adoption to himself as sons. It was then that our adoption process began with an official legal decree by God the Father. If you've never read an adoption decree, let me read some excerpts of one from more than 100 years ago. It says, in part, and now, this 21st day of February, AD 1922, it is ordered and decreed that Marion Ludwig shall assume the name of Ida Heimer and have all the rights of a child and heir of the said Ida Heimer and be subject to the duties of such a child, signed John Monahan, Judge. Now, I didn't pick this particular decree at random. It has some special meaning and significance for me because Marion Ludwig was my grandmother. And in February of 1922, she wasn't even 2 years old yet, so she couldn't have had any real idea what was going on. She couldn't have really given her consent in any meaningful way. She didn't contribute anything to the adoption. Her new mother, Ida, didn't know anything about her, what kind of child she would be, whether or not she would be worthy of such an adoption. Ida simply made known to the judge her desire, her intention to adopt Marion, and the judge granted her petition and ordered it to be so once and for all. And how much more, of course, our spiritual adoption, where God is not just the judge making the decree, he is the parent adopting us, giving us his name, along with all the rights of being his heirs. And again, he made this decree long before we were even born, before he created the world. He chose us for adoption not because of any qualities that he foresaw in us, anything that we could do to contribute to it or earn it, but simply based on his grace and love for us. So the Father decrees, the Father sends, and in verse 4 it says that when the fullness of time had come, God the Father sent forth his Son, Jesus, to accomplish what our adoption required. So what did Jesus do that was necessary for our adoption? Well, Paul says he was born of a woman, born a human being, and he was born under the law so that he could redeem those under the law. And especially here, the law of Moses that God gave to Israel. But Paul also seems to be including what he refers to up in verse 3 as these elementary principles of the world. It's a mysterious saying that we're not really sure what it means, but it could be that Paul's talking about the basic moral law that God built into his creation, the law that he writes on the hearts of every person, Jew and Gentile. And so Jesus had to be born under this more universal, broad law of creation that covered all people so that he could be the Savior of all people, Jews as well as Gentiles. And he accomplished our redemption by obeying perfectly this law in our place and dying in our place as lawbreakers. So Jesus had always been the divine Son of God. But what Scripture seems to describe for us is that by becoming born of a woman, born under law, keeping the law, dying in the place of lawbreakers, that Jesus somehow became the perfect human Son of God in our place, the Son that Adam was created to be and failed to be, the Son that Israel was called to be and failed to be. So in order for us to be received as sons, adopted as sons, we needed to be joined in faith to someone who was the perfect human Son of God as Jesus is. So the Father decrees our adoption. He sent forth his Son to accomplish it. What about the third person of the Trinity, the Spirit? Paul says in verse 6 that because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, the Spirit whose role it is to apply, deliver the benefits of Christ's work to us. I think by now we've kind of beaten the infomercial analogy to death, so I'll broaden it a bit and say when it comes to any product, especially for a medium or large-sized company, there are multiple stages of development with multiple people fulfilling each of the roles along the way. So someone designs the product, someone else manufactures it, and then someone else delivers it to the consumer. Now, analogies to try to describe the Trinity are always foolish at best and sometimes risky and in danger of heresy. But keep in mind, we're not talking about trying to come up with an analogy to describe who God is as one God in three persons. I'm just trying to illustrate in this way the work of the Trinity to accomplish our redemption, specifically our adoption. So I think this is a fitting analogy that illustrates that our adoption was designed by the Father, that it was produced by the Son, and that it is personally delivered to us by the Spirit with all of its benefits and privileges. And what are those benefits? Our third point for this morning. Well, Paul mentions three of them in this passage. First, in chapter 3, verse 25, we are no longer under a guardian. And Paul there referring, as we saw last time, to the law that God had placed over Israel to supervise them, to discipline them, because of how extensive, how demanding, strict God's law is, the people were constantly reminded of their failure, that they weren't good enough, that they would never be able to do enough to please the Lord. Maybe some of you have had a guardian like that, an authority figure in your life that was just impossible to please, a teacher, a coach, a boss, maybe even a parent who did nothing but criticize you, nothing but point out what you did wrong, never seemed to have anything encouraging or affirming to say to you, who never said, good job, I'm proud of you, only condemnation and rejection. That's what Paul is saying Israel's experience was like before Christ under the law as a guardian. But in verses 24 and 25, now that Christ has come, God's people are no longer under the law as a guardian. So when he says in chapter 4, verse 5, that Christ has redeemed those under the law, he means redeemed not just from the punishment of the law, but from the guardianship of the law. We still need to follow the law, of course, but we do so now from a place of peace and assurance that Jesus has already kept it perfectly in our place. So we've been redeemed, freed, delivered from the sense of failure that the people of Israel lived with, the constant sense of shame that they were not and never would be good enough to earn the Lord's approval and pleasure. If we've been joined to Christ by faith and we're covered by his righteousness, then God is already as pleased with us as he ever could possibly be. And it's from that place of peace and assurance that we can now look to the law as a helpful guide rather than a condemning guardian. So that's one benefit of our adoption as God's sons in Christ. The next thing Paul mentions in verse 29 is that we are heirs according to promise. Chapter 4, verse 7, an heir through God. Heirs of what, though, exactly? Well, think of some of the things that Scripture says. For example, Titus 3, Paul says that believers are heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Matthew 19, for example, Jesus says his true followers will inherit eternal life. And again, if this were an infomercial, we'd say, eternal life, great, I'll pick up the phone and call right now. But again, wait, there's more. In Galatians 5 and many other places in the New Testament, it says that believers will inherit the kingdom. Several times in the book of Revelation, it says that the believers will reign with Christ. I mean, what an incredible promise to look forward to. But if we think about our inheritance in Christ, with Christ, as something only to be hoped for in the future, then we're thinking of ourselves like the child that Paul describes in the beginning of chapter 4, a child that's still too young to receive his inheritance, and practically speaking, at that point, still no different from a slave or servant in the household. But that's not what we are in Christ. Look at what Paul says in verse 3. In the same way, we also, when we were children. In other words, we're not children any longer. We've already reached the age in Christ when our Father has given our inheritance to us. Not all of it, of course. It won't be until Christ returns that we begin to live and reign with him forever in the true and full sense of that. But in the meantime, our Father has given us a very real, partial, but very real and meaningful experience of the inheritance that we have in Christ. Think of John 6:47, where Jesus talks about eternal life as something that we have, not will have, present tense, here and now, from the moment we trust in him. Ephesians 2:6, Paul talks about being seated with Christ in the heavenly places as something that's a present reality now, in some sense. So Jesus is already enjoying his eternal rest. He's already seated at the right hand of the Father, where he rules over all things as King of Kings. So if we are in him, if we're joined to him by faith, then where he is and what's true of him is also, in some sense at least, true of us. We are already experiencing, as we remain here, groaning and waiting for our full redemption as sons, already experiencing some, at least, of the promised inheritance that we have in Christ, that we will live and reign with him forever and ever. But there's one more benefit of our adoption that Paul mentions in this passage, in chapter 4, verse 6. He says, because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. And here it's the Spirit who cries out to the Father on our behalf. In the passage we read earlier from Romans 8, Paul says that it's by the Spirit that we cry, Abba, Father, ourselves. That word Abba is from Aramaic, the common language of Jesus in Paul's day. It seems to have been a personal, more intimate form of the standard term for Father, Av. So some have suggested that it's closer in meaning to our English words dad or even daddy. But many theologians have kind of pushed back on that, saying, well, Abba wasn't just used by young children, so it's not a kid's word. It's a word that adults use as well as kids to refer to their fathers. And daddy, you know, is a child's word that we stop using when we grow up. And so it would be, you know, kind of too childish or immature or disrespectful to think about, let alone refer to a holy God in that way. And this seems to be, you know, the majority opinion among theologians, and with all due respect to my brothers who feel that way, I wonder if it's because so many theologians are men who stopped calling their fathers daddy a long time ago. My mother, a grown woman, as you might expect, still, to this day, refers to her late father as daddy. For her, it's not an immature, childish word. It's a term of deep endearment. That's still full of every bit as much respect and honor as the word father for her. And I'm sure many of you ladies here today, maybe many from that generation, still refer to your fathers as daddy in an endearing yet very respectful and honoring way. So I can't say I really buy this argument that Abba can't possibly have the sense of daddy, because that seems to be based on a faulty assumption that only young children use the word daddy. But having said that, I agree wholeheartedly, of course, that we should be very careful how we think about the Lord, how we address him, what words we use. So if daddy is a little too informal or casual, perhaps dad, a more respectful alternative. But really, if you think about it, any man-made word is going to fall short. It's going to be inadequate of the reverence that a holy God is due. Even the word father, really, in any language, fails to do justice to who God is. And yet, Jesus has given it to us, instructed us to use it as a way to address a holy God as our Father with this very human word. And here in Galatians 4 and in Romans 8, Paul says that we can and do call him Abba, which is clearly, I mean, I think without dispute, a more intimate, perhaps even informal form of address than the more formal Father. So informal, in fact, that we can't find any evidence in Paul's day that the Jews who addressed their earthly fathers as Abba would ever refer to the Lord that way. So if that's the case, why is Paul so comfortable using it here? Well, probably because Jesus himself used it in Mark 14 when he said, "Abba, Father, take this cup from me." Obviously, Jesus wasn't being disrespectful, let alone irreverent. His very next words, if you remember, were, "Not my will, but yours be done." But in that moment of overwhelming distress and sorrow, he addresses his father with a word that captured the kind of personal, deep, intimate relationship that they had. And here in verse 6, Paul is saying that if we have the Spirit of Christ in our hearts, then we have that same kind of personal, intimate relationship with the Lord that Jesus himself has, and that we can address him with this very same personal, even slightly informal word, Abba. But having said that, we should take notice that in the three places that it's used in Scripture, Abba, it's always followed by Father. So it's not something that we should use in place of Father. You know, it's not meant to suggest that we can be intimate and endearing with our Father without, you know, and lose any of the sense of reverence that we should have for him as a holy God as well. And since we don't know the best way to translate it, maybe the safest thing to do is just leave it as it is and say Abba. But if we're uncomfortable not just with the word, but with the idea of being so close and familiar, even informal, with the Lord, maybe we need to ask ourselves if we're being so careful to avoid being informal or casual in our relationship with him that we might go too far in the other direction and have a relationship with him that's so formal and so proper that we can't imagine addressing him or thinking about him in these warm, personal, familiar ways that are expressed with this word Abba. But maybe some of us are uncomfortable addressing God in this way, thinking of him in this way, because that's not the kind of relationship you had with your earthly father. Maybe he was very demanding and critical. Maybe nothing you did was ever good enough for him. Maybe he yelled at you a lot, or worse. Or maybe he was just emotionally distant. Maybe he was so busy or so away from the home that you didn't really have a relationship with him at all. But however bad or good, unhealthy or healthy your relationship with your earthly father was, if you are joined by faith to the Son of God, then you have a relationship with your heavenly Father that is infinitely better, warmer, closer, deeper than even the best of earthly relationships. Our Father loves us more than any earthly father ever could. He even takes pride in us more than, say, grandparents have in their grandkids. I mean, you grandparents know what I'm talking about, right? The kind of pride where you just can't stop talking about your grandkids, sharing pictures of them with complete strangers in the grocery store. Even more than that, our Heavenly Father is full of joy and pride over us. In Zephaniah 3, it says, "He will take great delight in you and will rejoice over you with singing." Isaiah 43, God says, "You are precious and honored in my sight, and I love you." The kind of love that Jesus illustrates in the prodigal son with a father who really, in an undignified way for Jewish sensitivities, hikes up his robe and runs to meet his son and embraces him and kisses him. How is it that a holy, God can have that kind of love and joy and pride for sinners like us? Well, because remember, if we are joined by faith to Jesus, then God has already poured out all of his anger, the anger that we deserve, on him. So he is still grieved, as any loving parent would be when we stray from him, but never angry in the sense of angry with the intent to punish. No, if we are in Christ, then our Father's opinion of us, his love for us, is secure and unchanging because it's based on his Son. Once and for all, the Father thinks of us and says to us what he said to his perfect firstborn Son: "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." Being justified, being acquitted by God as a judge, this is good news all by itself. But wait, there's more. If we are found in Christ by faith, then we are also adopted as God's beloved, deeply beloved, treasured, precious sons and daughters. An infomercial may try to convince you that you urgently need whatever they're selling, but there is nothing more urgent than being in a right relationship with the Lord. So if you're here today and you don't know God as your Father, don't change that channel. Don't wait another minute, in fact. Call right now. Call on him in prayer, admitting that you need his love and forgiveness, trusting that you have it because of who Jesus is and what he has done to pay the price for your sonship and mine. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the good news of our adoption in Christ. Father, help us to believe and to live each day with the assurance that we already have your love and acceptance, that we don't lose any of it by our disobedience, that we can't add to it by our obedience, that it is secure and unchangeable because of who Jesus, your Son, is and what he has done for us. And we pray this in his name. Amen. All right, our next hymn to help us prepare for the supper is number 253. Let's stand and sing, "There Is a Fountain Filled With..."
Thank you.
Please remain standing with your hymnal and turn in the back to page 855 for our confession of faith that seemed appropriate this morning to confess together what we believe about baptism, or about adoption, excuse me, before we partake of the supper. So we'll read together from the Westminster Confession of Faith, chapter 12, again, page 855 in the back of your hymnal. Brothers and sisters, what do you believe about your adoption? All those that are chosen. Be seated. As always, we begin with the words that Jesus used to institute this supper for us, and this time I'll be reading from Matthew 26. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, when evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Jesus' words, "This is my body, this is my blood," these are words that Christians sadly have been divided over for more than 500 years over what those words mean. Some Christians don't believe Jesus is present in any way when we partake of the bread and the cup. Others believe that he is physically present, that the bread and the cup somehow become his actual body and blood. As Presbyterians, we believe that he is really and truly present, but that it is a spiritual presence, that we partake of him spiritually by faith, not physically. And that's not because we don't believe that Jesus could be present physically with us. Last Sunday, we celebrated Jesus' resurrection, that he was physically raised from the dead, that he physically appeared to the disciples, including Thomas, and he still has that same physical resurrected body. But since it's a real human body like ours, it cannot be in more than one place at one time. So Scripture tells us that after he ascended, he sat down at the right hand of the Father, and there he has remained to this day, interceding for us as our great high priest. But the fact that he's not physically present with us here this morning does not make our experience of the grace of this sacrament any less meaningful. I mean, just like the fact that seeing him in Scripture with spiritual eyes of faith is any less sufficient for that faith than seeing him with our natural eyes as Thomas did. In fact, remember, Jesus said to Thomas, "Blessed are those who have not seen physically and have yet believed." So in the same way, blessed are those who are not seeing him physically present this morning and yet believe that he is really, truly, spiritually represented in the bread and the cup, present with us, and that this spiritual presence is a real and true experience of his grace for us that will give us real and true assurance that our sins have been forgiven and that one day we will see him with the physical eyes of our own resurrected, glorified bodies. If you don't understand that or if you don't believe that, then Scripture warns you not to take the bread and the cup this morning. They're meant for those who have trusted in Jesus for their salvation, who understand that the bread and the cup are visible signs and confirming seals of that salvation. This warning isn't meant to keep sinners away from the table. Otherwise, none of us could come. In fact, before we proceed, let's just pause for a moment and meditate on, reflect on, confess the sins before the Lord that Jesus came to give his body and blood to atone for. Father, as we partake of the spiritual but very real and true body and blood of your Son, please give us spiritual sight to see our sin and to see his sacrificial death that was sufficient to pay the penalty for that sin. We ask this in his name. Amen. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples. Jesus said, "This is my body. Take and eat." And then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples. cup is the blood of the new covenant poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink from it, all of you. Let's close our time in prayer. Lord, you are holy, are the God of all creation, worthy of our worship and reverence, and yet because of what your Son has done for our salvation, we also come to you this morning as your beloved sons and address you as Father, even with such an intimate term as Abba. So Father, would you use the grace of the bread and the cup that we have received this morning to strengthen us in assurance that we are truly your sons in Christ, and that we would live more and more out of the reality of that this week. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So as a hymn to help us think about what we have just received by God's grace, let's stand and sing together number 264, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross.
Thank you.
Now may grace, mercy, and peace be with you from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, his Son. Amen.